God in his sanctuary.
Through your praise, God, in mighty heavens.
Praise God's acts of power.
We will praise God's surpassing greatness.
Praise God with the sounding of the trumpet.
We will praise God with the harp and lyre, with timbrel and dancing, with the strings and pipes, with the clash of cymbals, with the resounding cymbals.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! Hallelujah! Amen! Praise the Lord!
Please be seated and let's have a prayer together. Loving and wondrous God, we look out and we see the sun fading slowly away, and we give thanks that we enjoyed a few hours of that bright sunshine today. We felt its warmth upon our face. We saw the clouds emptying from the sky and making room for the beautiful blue. We give you thanks that we are able to worship here, that we can take this time to enjoy our presence in your light, that we can take time to enjoy your Son, Jesus Christ, working with us, speaking to us, guiding us, holding us up, showing us how to live. We give you thanks that we can come here together to glorify and to worship you, and not just in this time with music and words and a reading of your word, but also in the meal that we just enjoy, in the work that we are about to do as a presbytery, and in the lives that you have given us. Now we offer you this time of worship together, and we ask that you receive our bodies, minds, hearts, and souls as we do so. For we come in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us these words of prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please rise and be comfortable doing so, and we'll sing together 10,000 Reasons.
Yeah.
Reading from Hebrews 3, verses 1 to 3. Keep on loving one another as brothers and sisters. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to the angels without knowing it. And selected readings from Matthew chapter 25. I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. One of the things that I have grown into over the many years, almost 60 that I've been around, is practicing hospitality. Subtitle for this message is Why I Love Presbytery Dinners. And it is something that I've always encouraged my congregations to do, is to open their doors and their hearts to the presbytery for a shared meal, for a time to give thanks to the presbytery for all it does, for all of that fellowship, paperwork, oversight, creative ministry opportunities that comes when we gather together, but also the opportunity of being able to bless one another with a gift. You know, the tradition is to bring the hostess a bottle of wine and flowers or a box of chocolate. But for me, it's having you come into my house, into my presence, and for me to be able to give you something, a gift, a kind word, a shoulder. Today, a space where we can do our work, and an amazing meal put on by a couple of amazing people who have done so much for this congregation. To me, this is the heart of my personal mission to welcome everyone. I actually have a workshop on how to welcome. And one of the hearts of this workshop is the first reading that we have here. Oh, go back, 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 the other back. There,
that one?
That's the one, thank you. Keep on loving one another as brothers and sisters. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. Now, there's a whole lot of exegesis that can be done on this passage, and we can talk about how the angels refer back, perhaps, to those voices that spoke to Mary and Elizabeth, or maybe to Jacob and all of that stuff. But I think the angels are the people that show up, that are themselves God's living presence in our midst. And sometimes God's living presence is a hale and hearty person who comes and eats everything in sight, and you wonder if you've got enough left over. And then sometimes it's that broken one who hardly eats anything but feeds off your company. To welcome somebody is not just a matter of having them come into the door of your church and the greeter trained professional to say, "Welcome to St. Swithin's by the Bog. It is nice to have you here. Here is a seat. Thank you. We hope you enjoy worship very much." The words may sound welcoming, but unless there's a welcoming heart within that congregation, unless that welcome is followed up by somebody actually sitting with this stranger, because it's the first time they're there and they're not sure what to make of a 78-page bulletin, or when to stand up or when to sit down, or if it's okay not to sing, or if they don't quite understand the big theological words that you use, The welcome is in the few minutes afterwards, when they get up to leave. Do they walk out in silence alone, or does somebody acknowledge their presence and say, "It was nice to have you here. We hope to see you back." And they feel, they don't hear, they feel those words in their heart as a welcome to return. The welcome comes in that moment when they walk into the door. And is it clear how to get to the sanctuary? And are there room, is there room in the pews? And is the sanctuary clean enough? Is it together? Do people feel like they want to be there or like it's an obligation? A welcome is not just a handshake, but a way of life. And there's a bigger picture that comes out of that. Next slide, please. Jesus says, "I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink." He describes these words of welcome, of actions that reached out to the broken, to the hungry, to the needy, to somebody who was in trouble and everybody else detested. And so they put them in jail. But a welcoming presence went to that jail and stood in for Christ. That is what it means to welcome. And it's not just angels that we do so in a moment, but Christ himself that feels at home, that feels welcome, that feels like they belong. So today, I was thinking about what to say, what to bring. And, you know, this opportunity at presbytery, my first preaching here, you can do your pet peeve where you point your finger at the presbytery and tell them all the things that they did wrong. And then that's your last time you're invited to preach. Or you can do your personal theological wondering and offer a sermon of deep, deep thought that goes over everybody else's head because it makes sense to you that they wonder what you're talking about. But I chose instead to tell the personal story of this congregation, of why this place means so much to me and why I think it means so much to our presbytery. And it begins with our welcome statement. Our welcome statement originated out of St. Andrew's, Sitzville. And it's that first line in purple that stands out. It is a welcome to LGBTQ people. It is a welcome to the broken. It is a welcome to the lost. It is a welcome to the poor, to the aged, to the young. Here in Coldwater, if you're familiar with the place, it's a welcome to steampunk and steampunkers. But it's a broad and it's amazing welcome statement. You can bring up the next slide. This is one of the most challenging reasons for me to be so affirming and inclusive here as a congregation. This is from NBC News, but it's not original to them. Many LGBTQ youth still fear rejection from their parents. About 40% of homeless youth are LGBTQ, with family rejection being the most cited reason why they don't have homes. Let's zero in on that a little bit. About 40% of homeless youth are LGBTQ. Think of that for a moment. Think of those kids having no place to go. And why is that? Go to the next slide. With family rejection being the most cited reason why they don't have homes. Family rejection. Your mother, your father, your brother, your sister rejecting you because you're gay or lesbian. Kicking you out because you're transsexual. This is the reality that we face, and it might seem uncomfortable, but it is a truth. And the other truth is so often, it's because what the church of what the church has taught the parents. And so they have this misguided understanding, what I think is a misguided understanding. And just go back two slides. Back to Jesus' welcome. Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers or sisters of mine, you did for me. So how is it that we welcome people? Do we welcome them wholeheartedly for everything that they are, accepting and affirming them, regardless of their sexual orientation, race, color, social status, wealth, whether they are Wesleyan or Calvinist or what's the other one? Lutheran, there's one. Do we accept them fully for who and what they are? And that mattered to me when I came here. Jim is sitting somewhere, there he is. And Jim, I think, might remember that one of our very first email conversations was me very bluntly asking, where does St. Andrews stand in terms of accepting and affirming LGBTQ people? Because if they don't, the conversation stops here. I was very blunt. You might have noticed that happens sometimes. And Jim answered in the affirmative, and so the conversation carried on. And that's why I feel so blessed to be here. You're told not to change anything in the first year that you've come to a place. And this welcome statement isn't a change. It's simply putting in print what we believe as a congregation. And coming to a small town, having grown up in Toronto, worked just outside of Toronto in Brampton and different places, I wonder what cold water was like in terms of receiving LGBTQ people. And a couple of weeks ago, I was at a euchre here in town hosted by the Lions, and a couple was there, two women who were married and happily so, and I dared to ask them, what is it like being a gay couple in Coldwater? And their response was immediate and positive and joyful. They said that they had no problem, that they loved being here, that they felt welcomed and affirmed and supported, and that there was only one person who sent an anonymous letter saying that they didn't like me. But the overall reception in this place was enough to support me and to let them know that they felt like they belonged. So I feel like I belong. One final thought. One of the ways I like to describe we children of God, we human thingies, is as being equally weird and wonderful. Equally loved and lovable. Equally welcomed, affirmed, and accepted by our Lord and Savior Jesus. That's who we are. Let's pray. Loving God, we come before you as your beloved children, men, women, intergender, transsexual, lesbian, gay, straight. We come to you in so many forms and so many shapes, with so many different mindsets, gifts, talents, looks, abilities, personalities. Yet, we are told that each and every one of us was created in your image. And if we were created in your image, then we are holy and beautiful and wonderful, albeit weird, things. And we give you thanks for that. We give you thanks for the Son that showed such a welcome to a Samaritan woman that he shouldn't have been speaking to. That he sat with tax collectors and sinners, with the rejected and the despised. He touched the sick. He touched the whole. He included and welcomed everyone. And we pray that we might be like that, God. That we might see one another not as odd bits, not as rejects, not as being without worth, but that we see each other as a brother or sister, as a child of yours, in whatever weird and wonderful form you have created us to be. I pray that as we gather for our meeting, that you will help us to set our egos aside, and that it is your will that is done. That you help us to come together in joy and in Christ-like service, so that it is He we honor. And that your Spirit so fill us that we might be of one mind and body, praising, glorifying, and working for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And we're going to sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Broken.
Amen.
And I turn it over to you.